Yeah, that will work. But normally try to use the same like what you are using, to use the same standard. No, when reading string also I showed you, right? It will work in single also. That is only without if you are just want to check something, so you can do that. So there are various braces. So that's why I covered, like you might see in different places different type of braces. So you should not get confused like that I have learned a single braces, now you're just showing something else. So there are multiple braces, you can use different type how you want to. Okay, so Frederick, which assignment do you see? 2, 3. Okay, so that what I said. See, if you see the third assignment, there is a note there written. Parameters should always be 2. So you should have, that's why I mentioned that there. So that's specifically that, okay, if you want to do a check, right? So you have to make sure that the user is always providing 2 parameters only. That's why I said, if I provide 3, then this is wrong, right? If I provide 3, how it will compare between 3? The script is written to compare between 2 scripts, right? So as soon as I have provided, I have given you a scenario only. So if I provide 3 parameters, it should actually say it's wrong, right? That the parameters that you have provided is wrong. It should not be 3 parameters. The script will not work. It should give you a warning or an error message directly. Getting? Hello. Okay, so the main script is that if I am passing 2 parameters in the command line whenever I am running a script, so it should always be 2, not less than 2, not more than 2. It should always be 2 parameters only user passing, because if I pass only 1, then what it will compare, right? So both the scenarios, you have to also think of scenarios, right? That if I have written this script, will it be true in all the scenarios or not, right? Because as soon as you do 1 or 3 parameters, 4 parameters, how the script will work? Because the script is only written. Hello? Can you hear me? I think your audio. We can hear you, Frederick. I think he is having some issues. Frederick, now you can hear me. So that was the assignment that, okay, you have to validate the scenarios as well. That's why I mentioned that. That was an important note there, that only the parameter should always be 2. If I pass 1, it should fail. If I pass 3, it should fail. It should not actually compare, right? That script shouldn't even go doing any action item, right? If, let's say, if I have not provided the correct input itself, it will not work, right? It should not proceed ahead to do any action items there. So that was the check there. That was the important part, that how you can check that only 2 parameters are passed, not less than that, not more than that. Now exit, how will exit work there? think on that class on the parameter when I told you the positional parameters. Revise that video again. See there I have told. There is a concept there that you have to use. Okay, it's a if condition only, that's why. But you have to know like what you have learned, how you have to use it, implement where. Okay, so that was the actual assignment that okay, you have to validate that always the parameter should be two parameters that are being passed. Okay. Yes. No. See, on the 10th one, what is the 10th? In 10th assignment, I think the one that you showed me, you are not checking whether the value is, you are just printing me 0 or 1 something. Right? So, that is not the desired result, right? It should tell whether the string that has been passed is a null string or a normal string with some value. So it should give me some output, right? 0 and 1, how will I know, right? Think of me as an end user. I don't know scripting, right? I don't know anything. You just gave me a program that, okay, use this program to validate whether the string that you are passing is a null string or is having some characters. Correct? So for an end user, how will I know? After seeing the output 0 or 1, does that mean? Right? It never shows anything there. If I just a second. You just pass the string, you are saying, okay, you are using the braces, double braces, and you are just printing it. It is nowhere checking the condition. If it is null, what it should print. If it is not null, what it should print. Okay, you just printed the return code. Whether it was success or not. Okay. So see, for end user, think as an end user. Don't think that the end user is technically sound, right? Like here we know that okay, we are into IT, so we know that okay, what it is happening. But for end user, it doesn't know. Okay. Yes. To check any condition, right? Whenever you are doing cell scripting, hello? Yeah, so anywhere, whenever there is an option to check a condition, right? If this happens, then you, hello? Am I not audible? Or maybe Frederick is having issue? Rajesh? Okay. I think there is some network drop by Udur and Frederick then. So I'm saying, whenever there is a condition check, that okay, you have to check a certain condition. So there you have to use your conditional statements every time. Okay, that you have to validate, okay, what conditions I am seeing and how I have to use them. So that's important, that how you have to use those conditions. Got it? So whenever there is something like, okay, you have to check this, whether it happens, it doesn't happen, checks whether the user is correct or not correct. So you have to go ahead and look for that particular condition checking statements. Okay. Yes, second assignment. Now you have to write, see, till the first assignment you have checked whether the path exists or not and it will print the path exists or path doesn't exist. Okay. Now I'm saying if the path exists, right? Write, create a file, but create a file using shell script, no VI or nothing. Okay, create a file using shell script and you have to go ahead and write a content inside that file, something dash dash dash, then date dash dash dash, then a next line I am present, then next line dash dash dash, full date and dash dash dash. So it should print something like that. So the output should be something like, if you can see my screen, it should be something like, let's say my date is, what is today, 20 July 21 dash dash dash. It should print something like this. Then it should print something like I am present, and sorry, anyway, that's not a command. And then again it should print something like 20 July. Of course the timestamp will also come, I'm just taking the date part here and this. So this should be saved in a file. So if that path is present, then this should be written to a file inside that path. Any file, any other file, not many file, don't try to name many file, but any file. But if only that path exists, then it should create a file and mention that, okay, I am present. So this whole is a format that should be printed or written inside that file. VI you don't have to use. That's what I'm saying. No, VI you cannot use any version shell script. Other way of writing is also there. Think of it. What we have learnt. One example I will give. If last time, if you remember, I have told you. Okay. Right. It does the same thing, right? Okay. So that's why I'm giving, because many times when you are doing logging and everything, so you are using inside it only. You cannot use it outside. What I also told Rajesh, right? Whenever you are running it, don't take the input from outside to a file, right? Write the input inside from the file, so that if in future session I will tell you, if you are sending a mail, let's say you are notifying by a mail, the script completed, fine. So that content of the file should be sent via mail only. If you are taking output from outside, so that means when the whole script is completed, then only the file will be completed. So how you will send inside from that mail? Okay, inside from the script. Got it? Yeah, so that's why I give him that whatever we have learned, it is useful, like it is used in the scripting. That's why I mentioned that. And yeah, so assignment 4, it says write a script to check if the script is already running. Let's say you have a script that will run for 10-20 minutes, okay, that is going to run for longer duration. So for testing that, you can do a looping, or you can do the same thing that you did last time, call the same script inside the script, okay. But in case, let's say you are running that script now, for me also, I want to also run, or we work on the same team, same development, so you have run a script and you went for a break. Now I came and thought, okay, no one has run this script, I again try to run that script. So if I again try to run that script, and it duplicates the data, right, it is doing some updates, it is doing some deployment, and it tries to duplicate it, so that will become a problem, right? It might become a problem. So I want that you should have a mechanism that if a script is already running, that time it should not allow any other user to run the same script. Got it? What is the requirement? Think of it. Can we do anything, something like this? We have like learned everything, like what we need to use for writing this script. I will tell you have to use touch command, you can use touch command, you can use rm, and you can use if else. This can be used. Got it? Any questions? Try to write it, else I will tell you. Let Rajesh also write. Let's see if he is able to write. And see if you are able to understand. Okay, if both of you are not able to write, I will tell you how to do it. Okay. Any other? Others? Okay. Okay. I hope that is clear, Ram. Okay, so today we will continue from where we left yesterday. So if else we have seen, right, the conditional statements. Now in the same, let me tell you one small command. Okay, again the tips and tricks part. First let me tell that. So let's say I was writing yesterday this script. What is this script? Okay. Let me not use this one. I'll use the other one. Okay, so this one I will use. Now see, whenever it is doing some action item, it is doing a error and doing a going some action item. But many times in a script what happens, you want to pause the script for some time. You want okay, pause the script for a specific duration and then execute further. So in that cases, what you can do, there is an option of sleep. Okay, there is a command known as sleep command. Sleep, and let's say I will say 10 seconds. So this value that I pass is in seconds. Okay, so I am saying that once this part is done, then what will the script do? It will sleep for 10 seconds. It will not go to the next line immediately. Okay, it will not go to the next line immediately. Rather, what it will do? It will wait for some time. So let me show you. Let me first uncomment it. Sorry, comment it. So I have commented. I will, if I run it, just condition. You see, if I enter a number, so it will say number was 23 and it is greater than 10, right? Immediately it has given me the result, right? Now, if I say okay, I don't want immediate, so I want to wait for 10 seconds before it should go to the next set of action items, okay? So maybe, so you can go ahead and use a sleep command along with that duration. So the duration would be in seconds, how many seconds you want to wait before proceeding to next. So now I will run it. So see, now you are connected to its correct user, but it is waiting. It is not showing me please enter a number. It is waiting for 10 seconds here. You see, now it has shown me the please enter me a number. Clear? Okay, so that sleep command is also used, like let's say if you are using some commands that will go ahead and run long time, and you want, okay, once that is done, I want to validate also from back end, from the other terminal, I want to validate whether that part was successful or not. So normally we keep a sleep command for let's say 10 seconds, 50 seconds, 120 seconds. 120 seconds means 2 minutes to wait before proceeding next. So meanwhile you can validate from the other terminals that whether the action item was correct or not. If it was not correct, you can press Ctrl C to cancel the script further execution. So Ctrl C to cancel that. So it will not execute further. Yeah, this is the line. Yes. Yes. Cron job. Yes, yeah. Yeah, that cannot, that time you cannot stop. Like, these are normally used when you are testing, or you know that, okay, it will take some time. It will take some time to validate. Okay, so you can go ahead and use it. Or you want, okay, the whole duration, once I run a command, it will take some time to sync. Let's say you are syncing some file system, right? But you want, okay, it takes some time to sync. So you say, okay, let's make my script sleep. Even it's a cron job, so let it sleep for 5 minutes. Okay, let it sleep for 5 minutes, and once that syncing is done, then it should proceed next. Okay, so many times you will be writing where the script should be interrelated. So like how we do, let's say we have a AWS job. Okay, so there are invoices that gets generated on AWS portal from government. Okay, so from government invoices are getting generated. So we have running the script that once that job gets generated there, it will pull the job in the first 5 minutes and then it will wait for some time so that all the job syncing is done, the file syncing is done. Once that is done, then it will again go ahead and do the next set of action items where it will proceed further of that invoices, whatever it does with that invoices. Okay, so that many places it has to use. So see, there are many options, many commands, like it's like unlimited commands you will go across. Okay, but which one to use where, it totally depends on what logic you are building. Okay, so it will totally depend on logic. So the same thing can be built in multiple ways. Okay, so it will be logic based how you want to do that. Clear? So, and one more tip and trick here. Now let's say sleep I'm using, but let's say I want to debug. Right now I don't know what is happening here. Whatever it is executing, right? I'm showing me the output. Let's say I want to debug my script. Some error is coming, right? So how you will identify what is happening, which variable value are getting replaced, which variable value are not getting replaced, right? So how it is validating that? So the best option is to use a something called as debug. So where you want, so normally we start a debug at the starting of the script only, after the bang line, which is called, how to do this, set hyphen x. So that will enable a debug mode. So as soon as you do set hyphen x, so whatever commands are being done here, whatever value are getting replaced, it will be shown on the screen, so that it will help you to actually debug the script, that what value it is picking. Is it picking the wrong value? Is it picking the wrong logic? Or whatever logic you have written, it is not going as per your wish what you wanted to do, and there is some issue in the logic. So most of the places this will be very helpful. So every time you have to debug, set hyphen x is there to help you out. So if I do wq, and let's say if I run it now, so see, as soon as I run it, so see the difference between this was just, it was showing me the output, whatever I have asked to show the output. But whereas, as soon as I run in a debug mode, what it did, it says that okay, there was a command who am I, which was substituted with its actual value, and now it was stored where, in V user, the value is Manchu, right? Ready? And then internally what it has done, it has compared the value $V user, what we have written, that value with the value Manchu only. Clear? Okay. And then you are saying it was printing that equal you are connected to a user, so it is going to print it, and then that line it is actually printing here where you are not seeing any plus sign. So there you will see this will be the actual line that will be printed on the screen. If you see a plus sign, means it is executing a command. If you see a double plus sign, that means it is substituting a value or it is executing a command there. Okay, so this is double plus sign, because who am I was being executed, and that value was stored in V user. Clear? And then see next command, sleep 10, so there is one plus sign only. Then plus sign equal, please enter a number, and then it will show on the screen this value, because it doesn't have any plus sign. So this will be the actual thing that will be displayed on the screen. And then see again plus sign, where it is reading vnum what we have written, so it is reading that particular variable. So I can say 30. As soon as I enter 30 and enter, it will do the next set of actions, that okay, next it will check the condition plus, that means it is doing some action here, and 30 is greater than 10, that is true, so it will go inside the echo and it will execute this command again. So plus sign is there, and there is no plus sign here, that means it is executing or showing on the screen. So this will be on your screen here, and then again it will execute the command exit 50. Got it? Let's see. Let's say see, till now there is no error, right? Till now no error is there. So till now the script was executed fine, right? Now let it sleep for 10 seconds. So now it is asking, enter a number. Now 20. You see, as soon as it shows 20, it says this condition is failing at line 30. Okay, so it will show you that it is trying to compare, but actually it is failing at line 30 here. Okay, so you have to match where it is actually doing. So it is trying to compare 20 greater than 50, because this line failed actually. See, this one failed. See, there is no space here. It failed here. So it is failing here. That's why what it tried to do, it tried to go to the else if condition. Okay, normally if this braces was correct, it would have not gone into the second line of the else if. Then the number entered is 20 and greater than 15, because 20 is already greater than 10, so it would have completed here only. Correct? But because this was failing, there was an issue here, it went that okay, there it cannot determine the state of this condition. So that's why it went to the next condition. And it found okay, 20 is greater than 15, so it printed that on the screen. Okay, so here it will show you. So it's like if I show you, so if I just insert it, let's say I am printing here R capital H. Okay, so if let's say your condition is only wrong, what you are checking, you see what it will easily also help you to debug that. Okay, what I gave who am I, so the value stored in the variable is Himanshu, this one. And the condition what it is checking is Himanshu equal to uppercase H then Himanshu, right? So they don't match here. So here is the issue, right? The condition is not matching. That's why it is not proceeding further and exiting from here. Got it? Further clear? Okay. So these are the two again very important things, sleep and set hyphen x for debugging your scripts. Okay. Now yesterday we were saying if else. So in if else, let's say you want to test multiple conditions, okay, or let's say nested if else also. I will tell you, let me correct it back and I will comment out sleep for now, else it will be waiting. I will comment out set hyphen x. So normally these you can keep it commented. If case of any issues, you can uncomment it, run the script, test it, and then once it is fixed, just comment it back. So there is no harm keeping it here. Okay. Now if I have written this script, right, this much is clear, right? So I will change this script now. So now you can also use nested if else. Okay, not only single if else but nested also. So nested means, let's say I will delete these lines. Okay, this, sorry, no, do not delete. Okay, so now I have written earlier the if else. Now what I will do, I will run and nested if else. Okay, now if I go ahead and do it here, let's say else if, so 5 oh. So now what it is doing here, first it will check whether the number is greater than 10. Okay, fine, it is fine. Once that is done, number is greater than 10, then I am not coming out of if statement. I inside that only am raising one more if statement, saying that check now whether the number is greater than 15 also. Okay, if check if the number is greater than 15 also, and if that is true, then what I am saying, this if I am closing it, this if, but still I am not coming out of this if statement. I am saying now check whether this number is greater than 20 also. So another if I am opening it here. So inside if it will run two if statements, one this and one this, and in case all these are not true, then it will go inside this else statement. So this else statement is for this if statement. getting it? So let me intend it a little bit. So that's why better to intend the lines. Okay, so now if you see it, if, and this is the if else closing statement for this if statement, and every if should have a closing statement for it. So inside that I'm checking. So the many first thing is that if this is never true, it will never get inside this anyways, because if this is false, that means this statement will be wrong and it will directly jump to the else. But if this is true, then it will go inside, print this line, and then it will check whether this number is greater than 15 or not, and if that is greater than 15, it will write, and then again it will also check whether it is greater than 20 or not. So inside this also you can put else, inside this also you can put else, else if, whatever you want you can put it. Only thing is, remember the condition, how it will going to work. It will check this and then comes inside this. Clear? So it is totally different what we have written earlier. Earlier it was an else if, that if this is not true, then check that. But here, if this is true, then only it will come inside and check that. Okay. So now if I run the same thing, let me run with set-x to show you how it is executing. Okay, so it is saying enter me a number. So let's say I will enter 5 for now. So anyways, 5 is not greater than 10, so it will not go inside the if, and it will directly go to the else part of that if, and it will print wrong number entered. Clear? But let's say if I go ahead and do it here, let's say 70. Now see what it has done. It has first entered inside if 70 greater than 10. This is true, good enough. It will print number entered 70 is greater than 10. Now inside again it will check whether 70 is greater than 15. Yes, 70 is greater than 15, it will print that. Then again one if also is there, 70 greater than 20. So that is also true. So it will go ahead and check that and print number 70 is greater than 20 also. Clear? Yes. Here you are seeing. Yeah, this one. Yeah, that would be else if. That would be part of the upper if statement. That becomes the part of upper if statement. Right? So it will be the part of this if statement if you are putting else if. But there will be a difference. It is saying if it is greater than 10, then only check these conditions. Yes. With else if, yes. Yeah, that can also be done. Yeah, that will also work. But again, there would be a different thing. That would be a different condition, right? Then that time it will not check both. It will, if it is true, it will not go inside the else if part. Okay. See, the logic will change. It totally depends on logic what you are testing. All three will be checked. But in that way, as yesterday I showed you, if the number is greater than 10, it doesn't check whether it is greater than 15 or 20, it doesn't matter to it, right? But here what I am checking, if it is greater than 10, check for it is greater than 15, it is greater than 20 also. Okay, that is also I am getting checked. But as soon as I put here if else, let's say, what you have said, so I will comment out this line and insert else. And see this one, this much you said, right? Now if I do the same thing, same example with the same value 70, what we have done last time, 70. So see, it has only done things where See, earlier it has checked 10 also, 15 and 20 also. But here now it has just checked 10, then inside that it checked over 70 greater than 15, that's it. It is not needed to check 70 greater than 20. So it will never check, because it is an else if. That else if means if the previous if was not true, then I will check else if. Okay. If the previous is true, it doesn't matter. Okay. Clear in this? Okay, so now let's say same thing. Okay, so I will make another script out of it. Now VI. So we are checking like this. Let's say I want that, okay, I will delete all these things. Okay, so now we have simple if. Now let's say I want to see if number is greater than 10 and I want to check if number is greater than 20 so or 15. So I can do the same thing that we just now I showed you with nested if else. Same thing I can do. But apart from that, we have one more method that we call as the Boolean checks. Okay, that is means that I want to check. So there are two options here. Or, so double pipe sign is or, and then and. Okay, so what does this mean? If this condition is true, and I am checking if V number is greater than 20 also. Now what will happen? This is AND condition. So if you have learned any logical operator, what happens? AND means if any first one fails, it is not going to check the second one anyways. Okay, so for AND both the conditions should be true. If first is true, then it will check the second one whether the second is true also or not. Got it? Okay, so I will say, let's say R. So I want to check whether the number you are entering is greater than 20. Okay, so now if I go ahead and save it and let's say run with something, let's say 15. See what it has checked. 15 greater than 10, that was fine, but 15 greater than 20 was not true. So that if condition will fail now. Okay, so it will directly go to your else statement that okay, that is not true. Whereas if I run it, PS2 let's say 70, then you say okay, the number is both the condition is getting true, so it will go ahead and directly check that okay, the number is greater than 10 and number is greater than 20. Clear? So see, it is checking both condition. But now let's say if I go ahead and do 5. So see, earlier it checked both conditions, see both whatever is there, both whatever is there. But when I enter 5, so the first condition itself it fails, 5 greater than 10 false. So if we not check the second condition, because there is an AND sign, right? AND is there. So it will not check the second sign and directly go to your else part here. Clear? So AND means whenever you are using AND, AND means both should be true, and when you are using with if condition, so that means if the first condition is true, then only it will check the second condition, that whether it is true or false, then only it can decide whether it should go inside if or it should go inside outside if, whether in else or it should go outside else if, whatever you have written. Okay, but if I am using OR here, OR means it is not checking that both should be true. Any one should be true, that's more than enough. Okay, so here I will replace it with okay, or. So the two pipe sign is your or symbol. Okay, so here as soon as I do like this, so even if this condition is true, it will consider this whole if to be true and it will go inside it. It doesn't matter whether this is true or not. Got it? Okay, so if I show you the same with example. So let's say first I enter 5. So see 5, now it is checking for 5 when you are using OR. Now it will check both because it wants at least one should be true. So because both are not true, so it will go to else. But as soon as I do, let's say 16. So see, it has found that over the first condition is getting true. That means it is fine. So it will simply print me the statement written inside the if statement. Clear? Okay, so this way you can use the boolean condition checks as well. Get it? So this is how your if else will work here with boolean. So you can do multiple checks in the same specific boolean. Yes. How you will use? But logically that will fail, right? How will logically you will correct it? See what happens. Let's say you are checking. So as I told, if or is used here, right? Or means whether this is true or this is true. So if any two it finds, it will print it directly. Okay, it will directly print it. Whereas if you are putting AND, it has to check both. Okay, both should be true. Anyone fails, it will consider it to be failed. Okay, so you can get the error saying, okay, this is not true and this is not true. Okay, so let me show you it here like this. Yeah, then you have to find out. Yeah, let me show you. That you can do, but that logic normally doesn't hold true in real time. Normally you don't do that. Okay, so you are referring this. Let me show you. Right? Let's say AND. Than 30. Okay, now let's see here. Okay. See, it is unable to check what is the syntax here. You can use nested one. Okay, nested one can be used here. Okay, that to validate. Okay, so this is how you can go ahead and do the condition testing. Okay, now apart from if, you have something also called as other condition statement, that is called as case. Okay, one is your if, right? Now other is a case. Now there is a difference, very slightest of difference. In case you are given various options that if you want to choose this, you want to choose this, based on that it will do an action item. If it's going based on the condition that if it gets true, then it should go inside it. Whereas case you will get various options, and based on that options you can actually go ahead and do your tasks. Okay. Now how the case syntax is there? Case is also a conditional statement. Case, your variable name, whatever, in, and you have various options. Let's say some option, whatever option you want to give, option in this set of actions, and the option would be closed by double semicolon. Then option 2, I will show you how we write it for now. Set action, and then okay, and then in case, let's say all the option, like in if you have, at last you have an option as else, right? If none of the things are true, else it should print like this. Same way in case also we have. So in case both options are not there, option 1 and option 2 are not provided by the user, let's say 1. So last option you have star, that okay, in case no of these options are there, then go to star and set the action, whatever action you have written, semicolon, and then how to close that case, same like if the reverse was 5, for case the reverse is ESAC, the reverse of case characters, so that is reverse here, clear? Okay, I will show you the script first. Let's say case underscore class dot sh. So let's say I write a menu equal. Let's add anything with you. Let me give you some options as. So this is just blank printing. I'm just printing it right now. And then I will copy this line. Now if I simply run this, so what it will do, it is just printing blankly. So if I am doing it, what it has done, it has just blankly printed anything, right? So what I have done, I have just written till here, correct? So it has printed me menu on the screen. Now the next thing is, this is also a way to write a script when you are writing a big script, right? So you have to divide it into parts. So the first part was to display me menu. So I was successfully able to display menu on the screen, clear? So when I run this, it will display me menu on my screen. That was fine, good enough. Now next I want to take the input from the user. So the input from the user should be something like 1, 2 or 3, okay, which number you want to take. So how to take an input from the user? Yes. So next part, so that's how you can break a big script in a module, okay. So next part I want to take an input, so I can say echo please enter a number between 1, 2, 3, okay, and close it, and then I know read command, so I will use v underscore ord, any value variable what you want, and save it. So the next part I have completed till here, that it will ask me number and store it in a variable. So if I enter something here, it will take it, but next action, there is no next action that is available. Okay, got it? Okay, so till here we are done. Now next, when you are writing, now the next thing is that I want to do some action based on that. Let's say if the user selects 1, it will say okay, you have selected idli. If user selects 2, it you have selected dosa. If user selects 3, it should print you have selected juice. Okay, based on that it should do. So here when you want that some options, you are giving options to the user. It's a conditional, but based on the options that the user is providing. So in such scenarios, what we will use, if else will not be beneficial, right? If else you will not be very much beneficial, because every time it has to check. If else will also work. You can do if, then else if, else if, else if, how many else if you want, and then else and then exit. But better option than if else here would be your case statement. Okay, so how the case will be now written? Case dollar v underscore order, that if this in what options it is. So what I'm going to give, I'm giving option as 1, 2, 3. You can also take input as idli, dosa or juice. So based on that the options will change. So for now I will put 1. For one option, what it will do, you have to first give option and this brace parenthesis, that okay, if someone is entering 1, it will do this set of actions, and it will do echo you have selected idli, and to close this option double semicolon. Same way, second option echo you have selected dosa, and close this option. Third echo you have selected juice, close this option, and you can close case ESAC. Okay, and save it. Now if I run it here, see, it will ask me, enter me a number, because I want to take the option as numbers. If you want to take the option as the values, you can put like that. If I put 1 here, it will show me you have selected idli. Correct? Correct? Now, let's say if I am running like this and some number I give 5. So it doesn't know what does 5 means, right? Because there are no options for 5. Same way like in if you don't have any else statement. So it will simply come out without giving you any message. So but you want that, okay, no, something should be there in case any wrong input is there. So what you can do, O and put star. So anything other than 1, 2, 3, 4, it will come to star. Echo wrong number was selected exiting. So by default it will exit the case and save it. If I run it here and if I get numbers on 4, it will say wrong number was selected exiting. Got it? Okay, and it, you don't need to only use the numbers. Okay, so if you are getting confused with numbers, let me remove the numbers also. So now I want the option as, let's say I will take it as idli only. Insert, delete, idli. So you have to type the whole option then every time. Insert, delete, dosa. Of course they are case sensitive, so if you are taking option as I capital and then everything is small, so the same input should be there. Then 1, 2, insert, delete, reduce. Okay, and save it. I will see, please enter. I will change it because it will be confusing. Play enter. Okay. Order. Value. Save it. Okay. And now if I do it, see, now it will show me what should I enter. If I enter 1, it will say wrong number was selected. Wrong was selected because it is 1 is no such option in case, right? There is no even option. Because I have changed it, so I will run it something as dosa now. So now it will take it, okay, you have selected as dosa. Got it? Okay. So this way you can use your case statements as well in your shell scripting. Yes. Yeah, this it's all almost over. Case was the conditional statement, so it's done. Okay, so I'll be wrapping up. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is how your case works. So any doubt? So these are the two conditional statements normally that you will be writing script based on this only, either if else or case, and it totally depends on you which you want to use. So whatever yesterday you have written with if else, now try to write with case today. Okay. Whatever scripts you have written yesterday with if else, now try to write if you can write with case statements, how you will write with case. Okay, so anyone you can use totally depends on your. Okay, so in shell scripting, everyone who is comfortable in which particular statements more, they will use both, or they will use that particular statements more often. Okay. No, nothing like that. See, the shell will work the same way. It will interpret each lines. Okay, so it's nothing like if else or something. Okay, but case mostly we prefer where you are using some menu based option. Let's say you are doing an application deployment script. Now if you want to deploy an application, so you can simply go ahead and select that, okay, I want certain options. That if I do like this, it should do particular task. If I do the other thing, it should do a separate task. So based on that, it should go ahead and do that. Clear? So in that case, you prefer to use case rather than if else. Okay? Because you know that I am giving users multiple options, and based on the option, user will enter some value. So in those type of places, better to use case. Okay? Okay, so try to write all the scripts for if else with case if you are able to do that. Okay, not the ones that you will not be able to write, but I will give you some more. Okay, if else, like if you are checking a condition, right, 1 greater than 2, that you cannot do in case, of course. Okay, but where you are checking the options, that okay, if this is there or if this is there, so in those type of places you can use that. Like you are checking username, right? Username is Himanshu or Bob or Freddy or let's say Rajesh. So whatever you are using. So in those type of places you can do it. That who is running this script. So it might capture that based on that particular name. Okay. So try to do it. I will send the assignment as well. Okay. But wherever you want, you can try to use case as well. Yes. See, inside it, if you are doing it, that log file, because see, set-x is printing there on the screen, right? So you have to redirect the script output to this particular file. So it's like if I'm writing it and I have to redirect it to some file, let's say 10-pan log file, something like this. So whatever it will show on the screen, other than it will capture in the log file. Okay. No, you will have to redirect outside because it will just show you the debug. Okay, so set is again a command. Okay, so you can go ahead and do set hyphen help. So you have multiple options, right? So man set. So you have lot of things. So you can read again how the shell set works. Okay, so there are various options. Okay, so X is the most common option that it will totally display. Okay, so I will wrap up for today. We'll continue tomorrow. Okay, so these are the conditional statements that are completed. Okay, fine, thank you, bye.